You probably know me best as one of the few YouTubers left who are still singing praises of the 3DS family. So it'll probably surprise you to find out that I actually went and bought a PS Vita in 2018. Why did I do that? I am a huge fan of the PSP. This is no secret. I seriously love this console. And I realized recently that I actually owe Sony a debt of gratitude because the PSP, along with this camera right here, which I had framed, the CyberShot W80, these two things, with yet another Sony product, Sony Vegas, the video editor, is what allowed me to have a quote-unquote YouTube career. My original channel, where I have about 500,000 subscribers, it started basically as a PSP channel, doing very much what I do here, but I guess I wasn't that great at editing video. Because of that, I have this sense of gratitude towards Sony, and I found this white PS Vita, the 1000 model, so the one with the OLED screen, for a really decent price on Facebook Marketplace, and I had to pick it up. Now, this isn't my first Vita. I had one a few years ago, which I ended up selling because I never played with the thing. But the right price, and especially, like I said, the white model, I really like the look of white portables like this. I wish there was a white Switch. As you know, the Vita is virtually dead outside of Japan, where it lives off of JRPGs and visual novels. Neither genre is really my cup of tea, so I knew going in that that's not what I'm buying this thing for. Now, before we can figure out if this is even a worthwhile purchase in 2018, it's important to realize why the Vita failed. We have to go back to the launch. So, the Vita didn't have the strongest launch lineup. I mean, it's rare that a console has a really good launch lineup. The N64, a console that so many of us remember so fondly, launched with two games. Yeah, but the Vita was pricey. At launch, it cost $250, $300 if you wanted to spring for the 3G version, which allowed you to put in a chip like a SIM card that you have on your phone to play online games wirelessly wherever you are, which is pretty cool. But again, $300 plus another data plan on top. So it's no surprise that the 3G enabled version of the Vita wasn't long for this world. So this is what Sony put on the table, a $250 portable with virtually no games, that costs almost the same as its big brother version, the one that you play on in your living room on your TV. You have to compare that to the competition, the 3DS, which had released a year later. Now, the 3DS also didn't launch with a great price. It was $250, the same $250 Sony wanted for the Vita, but Nintendo had the common sense to drop the price of the 3DS from $250 to $169 in July, a mere 5 months after launch. They had the money to burn from the success of the Wii, so they decided they wanted to hedge their bets on the system really working. The Vita would also see a price drop, but that would not be until February the next year, in 2012, when the 2000 model, the lighter, slimmer, but missing the OLED screen, Vita came out. So the Vita now, the original, this guy right here, dropped to $200, still a little more than the 3DS, and just too little, too late. And then the library. Sony really didn't put a lot of trust in the system, it seems. It almost feels like they just did it because they felt like they have to maintain a foothold on the portable space. Now, again, I have to say this every time the PSP is brought up, though a lot of people associate the PSP with failure, this thing sold 80 million units. That's, and this is the comparison I always go with, that's Super Nintendo and Sega Genesis, but together. They sold as much as this guy sold. So it took a beating to the DS, but that's because that thing printed money. The PSP wasn't exactly a failure, at least if the metrics we're going by is hardware sales. Yes, it didn't sell as many games because of piracy and all, and we're gonna touch on that, but it wasn't a clunker. Now, about library at launch, and this is where the 3DS just completely annihilated the Vita. If you buy, and I'm using a new 2DS XL as a surrogate for the 3DS because they're essentially the same console. So 3DS family, imagine my girlfriend has a 3DS, the original one, I would use that right now if she was here. Anyway, think of this as a 3DS, okay, because that's basically what it is. When the 3DS launched, it wasn't cheap, $250, but you had the benefit of playing your old DS games. So if you have a huge back catalog of DS games that you still hadn't had the chance to get into, or there's games that you bought and you played a little bit but never got around to beating, like it's my case with 99% of the games I bought, when this thing came along, what Nintendo was basically saying is, hey, you can still play those games. Just sell your old system, upgrade to this one, keep playing them. Even though the launch library wasn't that strong, never is, you can still play a whole bunch of DS games. Think of all the Pokemon games you could run on this thing at launch. This thing, on the other hand, didn't have the same benefit. So as you know, I don't have any UMDs on the drive here, but the PSP worked with Universal Media Discs, which weren't very universal because they only ran on the PSP, but there were these little discs, and that's how you'd play your games and watch your movies. So if you had a big back catalog of physical PSP games, this thing did nothing for you. You couldn't play them. You have what's out when it launched, and that's it. So the people who already had a PSP didn't have a very compelling reason to upgrade to this thing, because you'd have to get rid of your whole library. Now, if you bought your PSP games on PSN, like it was the case with PSP Go owners, because that was the only way for you to buy your PSP games, then yes, you can download them here from the PSN and enjoy them on the new hardware. But going back to the piracy thing, not that many people bought PSP games, let alone PSN PSP games. That's why the Vita failed to get any momentum. It had a rocky launch, a terrible launch lineup, it wasn't backwards compatible with the previous system, and it was competing with something that was cheaper, had more games, and overall, just had more mindshare. People coming to the 3DS had the DS in mind. Remember I mentioned the thing printed money? Everybody knew what the DS was and what it was capable of. So this thing, even though it wasn't super attractive in the beginning, that's why Nintendo had to slash the price, it was still in people's minds. People kind of knew what this was. But the Vita, on the other hand, as a successor to the PSP, a lot of people just didn't know what the PSP was or didn't care that much for it. What I'm trying to say is that for the casual consumer, this thing, people kind of knew what it was. This thing, maybe not so much. I want to say the best reason to buy a Vita is because you can play my game on it, and I realize now that I probably don't talk too much about my game. I have a game, it's called 99 Vitas, as you can see there. Focus is not going to work, but yeah. It's a 16-bit style beat-em-up that's based on a podcast that I started a few years ago with a couple of friends of mine. It's the number one gaming podcast in Brazil right now. But you can play it on the Vita. We put it out for every console. It's coming out for the Switch soon. But you can also play on the Vita, and no lie, one of the reasons I decided to pull the trigger and buy this thing is because I figured I'll be able to play my game on yet another console. I'll leave the link down there for more information. Anyway, why did I buy this thing? Well, the homebrew scene is pretty robust nowadays with the Vita, so you can unlock it, you can run homebrew and emulators and things like that. Now, of course, the emulation scene has taken a hit recently with Nintendo shenanigans and emulation sites pulling down their content, but I'm still a lover of emulation game preservation, even though I already have a whole bunch of systems that run games. I just can't help myself. I love seeing these old games running on newer hardware, especially with this OLED screen. The game is just pop. In fact, with my first Vita, I hacked it and I was running, you know, Super Nintendo games and things like that. And I wasn't super familiar with the hardware of the Vita itself, so I didn't understand why the graphics just pop, why the colors were so deep and the contrast so sharp. And then I found out it's because of the OLED screen. It makes it a great, great emulation experience. I can't say that I recommend it fully as opposed to other solutions like, say, the GPDXD, which I personally consider the absolute best way to emulate. But it's an interesting piece of hardware. It's made by a company that I kind of owe my YouTube career to, and I want to see what it's able to do. So in the next coming weeks, I'm going to be experimenting with it some more, and expect a video about everything this thing can do, from the legitimate games to the, you know, gray area stuff like emulation and things like that. So stay tuned. Anyway, that's all the time I have for today. As always, if you like this video, hit like, subscribe, leave a comment down there. I love to read your comments. I'm especially curious to find out where you guys are from. I'm from Brazil originally, and I've been creating content in Portuguese for years, but now making content in English, it's amazing to see the people that I can reach that I couldn't before. I get comments from the Philippines, Mexico, India, a lot of African countries. It's really interesting to me to see all these people coming together and kind of realizing we, despite being so different, kind of grew up the same way. We kind of have the same childhood stories about the same games. I find that fascinating. So let me know what you think in the comments down below. Hit me up on social media. I'm very active over there. I love hearing back from you guys. My Twitter and Instagram are down in the description. And that's all the time I have for today. I'm Izzy, and I'm done.